Let's look at the homeostasis loop. You have an input signal, could be your body temperature. Say you have body temperature, okay? You will send it to the control center. Control center is in your hypothalamus. And if your body temperature is too high, it will go to the output. Output is your sweat gland. And as sweat gland, okay, produce sweat. And when the sweat goes to the surface of your skin, it evaporates, it brings the heat away, so it lowers your body temperature. So this is the homeostasis control system. And in your body, okay, you just have a lot of this kind of system, control your body temperature. And you have the stimulus, you have a receptor pick up the signal. Could be the receptor on your skin, pick up the stretch, the temperature, or it could be the receptor inside your body. And you're going to send the information to the control center. The control center is going to send the signal out. And the one response is called the E-factor. Like the previous example, I say your body temperature increase and you sweat. The E-factor will be your sweat gland. And eventually your body temperature lower and there's a homeostasis. And this kind of control loop, your body have a lot. It can control your body temperature, it can control your blood sugar level, it can control your osmolarity in your body. And we talk about this component. Say your body temperature increase, okay, you have a sensor and they send a signal and to the integrating center. Then you go to the effector, that's your sweat gland, and the response, sweat. Eventually your body temperature drop. And the output can work as a feedback because the input, so it goes through the negative feedback. So your body temperature drop, and it won't keep dropping until your body temperature go to 70 Fahrenheit and you freeze to death. And the reason is the body temperature drop, it can work as an input. When the temperature drop to normal, and that's good enough, you won't sweat anymore. So we call this kind of loop, negative feedback loop. So you are able to maintain something because your body have a lot of negative feedback loop. And you have a set point for your temperature, for your blood sugar level, or like last time we talked about osmolarity, and about 300 mSM, that's your set point. And here are two examples of homeostasis. So if your body temperature is too high, well, we talk about this, you sweat, right? If your body temperature is too low, still your hypothalamus, that's your control center. And this time it's not your sweat gland. When your body temperature is low, you're shivering. It will send a signal to your skeletal muscle. When your skeletal muscle contract, it creates a movement. That's the main purpose. But this time its byproduct is heat. And this time we want the byproduct. So the heat gonna warm you up. That's the purpose, you are shivering. And your body just have a lot of this kind of loop. And homeostatic response can be local, can be systemic. So we talk about maintain your body temperature. These are systemic because it require long distance communication. Could be local, could be those paracrine signal in your digestive system. And these are local signal. Or when we talk about the last unit, the renal system. Your renal control, your glomerular filtration rate, your GFR, your filtration rate need to be constant. And these feedback, this control are mainly local, so they are paracrine. And if it's systemic control, long distance control, your body have two long distance control system, and the nervous system and the endocrine system. The nervous system, let's talk about one, like simple neuronal reflex. You touch something hard, you quickly move your hand back. This is simple neuronal reflex. So the signal, that's the heat, go to your skin. Your skin is the receptor. It can send the signal through your sensory neuron and will go through the dorsal part. Your dorsal part is the sensory input. We'll talk more about this in the nervous system. And it will go to the integrating center. Integrating center is your spinal cord or your brain. This time it's your spinal cord. It will go to the output through your motor neuron as your skeletal muscle to contract. So your response, you move your hand back. And the purpose of this is decrease the damage, because the sooner you move your hand back and the less damage you can create. When you do your neural health check, they can do this kind of the check. They won't ask you to touch something hard, you can sue them, right? But they can take a small hammer, they hit your knee when it hit your knee, it's actually the receptor is in your called the muscle spindle. It's buried inside those quadriceps muscle, those big muscle. And when they hit the knee, you're gonna stretch the quadriceps muscle. When they've been stretched through the sensory neuron, you can send the information in, and through the motor neuron, it will go to contract those quadriceps muscle, relax the hamstring muscle, so end up you kick. So that's how they test this response. This circuitry, neuronal circuitry, is still working. And this is simple neuronal reflex. It can be the endocrine. So let's look at the simple endocrine reflex. After you eat a big meal, your blood sugar level is high. Okay, go out of the higher than the set point. And your body, your pancreas, is going to release insulin. Insulin's function is to lower your blood sugar. So it will go through the blood. Blood carry those endocrine signal. It will reach the target cell. The target cell is skeletal muscle. This is the main target cell. And also your adipose, your fat cells. And both of them will, through the upregulation, we just talk about upregulation, they're going to put more insulin insulin receptor and put more glucose carrier on the cell membrane. And when you have more glucose carrier, you're going to carry more glucose into the cell, so blood sugar level drop and maintain homeostasis. So for normal people, healthy people, you won't have high blood sugar level problem after you eat a big meal because your body have insulin. If your blood sugar level is too low, that's not good because you can be dizzy, you can fall into coma. So your blood sugar level goes too low, your pancreas, still your pancreas, alpha cells gonna release glucagon. Glucagon's function is to increase your blood sugar. It will go to your liver. So in your liver, you have a lot of glycogen. That's the polysaccharide. It's a lot of sugar together. And you're gonna cut those glycogen, become monosaccharides. It's the simple sugar, that's a glucose. So your blood sugar level start to increase. You may have the experience, you feel very hungry, but after 20-30 minutes, you're still hungry, but it's bearable. And the reason is this circuitry response. So when your blood sugar level drop, that's why you feel hungry. And when you reach the certain level, you're gonna set this. And glucagon release and increase your blood sugar. So your blood sugar level is maintained. And we talk about diabetes. Diabetes is this one. Right? Either their body don't have insulin, that's diabetes 1, or their body become insensitive to insulin, that's diabetes 2. And they won't be able to go through the signal transduction pathway to put more glucose carrier on the cell membrane, and the blood sugar level remain high. And this high blood sugar is going to damage the filter, which is the kidney. It can also damage the small blood vessel. And your eye, that's the area. Retina have a lot of small blood vessels. They're all small blood vessels, capillary. And when they got damaged, the retina, the rods and cones, photoreceptor dies. And turn out, they become blind. So diabetes is the number one reason to cause blindness in the United States in the 21st century. Because we have 20 people have high blood sugar problem. So there's a simple endocrine reflex to maintain your blood sugar level. And a lot of things in your body, body temperature, blood sugar, blood pressure, and they just need to stay in the normal range. And next time we'll talk about osmolarity, that's the same. They stay in the normal range. And the mechanism, negative feedback. So we talk about the negative feedback, the output can work like an input, right? And could be the control your body temperature. So when your body temperature go back to normal, okay, your body knows stop this process. That's negative feedback. And we also have positive feedback. Positive feedback is the output and gonna work to amplify the signal. You may have the experience, you found some people they are using the microphone and they found the speaker is too close to the microphone. So the signal goes through the speaker, being amplified, being picked up by the microphone, again, being amplified again. And quickly it go out of control. So you found you hear a loud, sharp more noise. And this is positive feedback. So positive feedback is not stable. It's not stable. And that's why your body don't have too many positive feedback. Most of the feedbacks are negative feedback, like the one control, maintain your blood sugar, maintain your body temperature, they're all negative feedback. Your body has three positive feedback. They don't contribute to homeostasis, which is a stable environment. They don't. But your body have the three positive feedback. They are feedback loops, positive feedback. The first one, milk letdown reflex. Milk letdown reflex, it happens in female. So when the baby sucks the nipple, that's the stimulus. The sensory stimulus is going to go to the control center, that's the hypothalamus. It's going to trigger a hormone release called oxytocin. Oxytocin is a hormone release from the posterior pituitary gland. We will learn it later. And it will go to the breast and it will ask the milk gland to release milk. And it's a positive feedback, so quickly the baby learned, okay, the harder I work and the more food come out, so it's a positive feedback. And it need to be positive feedback. Because if it's a negative feedback and the baby try to eat and it stop, well then the baby won't get food. So this is a positive feedback example. And the other two positive feedback, the second one, blood clotting. This happens in both male and female. So blood clotting is the blood when they come out of the blood vessel. And in the blood, you have platelet. It will trigger a response. So they will start to form a chemical response. They will recruit the blood clotting factor. And it will start to form the clot. And at first, a small clot. And this clot will become bigger and bigger. So they start to recruit red blood cells because you have so many red blood cells. And this is when you see the dry blood. So what the clotting will become bigger and bigger. And it's a positive feedback. And you need positive feedback because eventually you need to stop bleeding. If it's a negative feedback, you form the clot, it disappears. And eventually this person is going to bleed to death. So that's a positive feedback. Happens in both gender. The third one is giving birth, uterine contraction. So during the labor, it starts from the small contraction in female. So you found those three positive feedback, two in female, only one in both gender. And start from the uterus contraction. And this contraction is small and short frequency. So every 30 minutes, and the pregnant woman found, oh, I have a contraction. I feel a little bit uncomfortable. And it's a positive feedback. So this contraction starts from every 30 minutes per contraction, go to every 20 minutes, go to every 10 minutes. And the contraction intensity start to increase. So first they feel, oh, uncomfortable. And that's the time to tell their husband, hey, honey, it's time to go to the hospital. And now it become pain, more painful. And it will keep contracting. So the cervix, the opening of the uterus start to open. You start from 1 to 2, means 2 centimeters. And it will keep going, it's a positive feedback. So it will go to 4, 5. Oh, that's the time the wife grab the husband and say, it's all your fault, right? It's very painful. And it will keep going, it's a positive feedback. So it will keep going until it go to 10. 10 means 10 centimeter. And until the baby's head come out and finish this labor process. So it's a positive feedback. Because if it's a negative feedback, start from uterine contraction and the brain shut it down, then the baby will never come out. So you only have three positive feedbacks. A milk letdown reflex, labor, uterine contraction, both of them in female only. And the third one, blood clotting, happen in both gender. So in the anatomy and physiological point of view, yes, the female's body is more complicated than male. Male's body is simpler. The reason is the baby need to grow inside. So baby, female's body is more advanced than male. In the anatomical term, point of view. Okay, so we talk about those neuronal reflex, simple reflex. We talk about the simple neuronal reflex, like take a hammer, hit your knee, you're gonna kick. That's belong to this one. We also talk about the simple endocrine reflex. That's this one. That's the insulin control the blood sugar. And we also talk about the neurohormone reflex, like a milk letdown reflex. So the start from the stimulus in the nipple and eventually gonna release the neurohormone, trigger the milk gland, release the breast milk. And the next topic, when we go to the neuroendocrine reflex, the circuitry become more and more complicated. Okay, that's it for today.